All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for giving us this time. We thank you for the opportunity you give us to be able to come together, to worship you, to praise you, to be able to look in your word together. And we ask even now, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would teach us and bring understanding of your word to our hearts and to our lives. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we're in Acts chapter 14. Acts chapter 14. As we continue in the book of Acts, we see that Paul and Barnabas were sent from Antioch in Syria. There's a couple Antiochs that are mentioned here. And Pisidia Antioch and the Syria Antioch. In Antioch of Syria, that's where really the church grouped together and were sent out on these missionary journeys. And Paul and Barnabas had taken their first missionary journey and were sent out into the land to preach the gospel. Now, as they were sent out, they were actually received by many, but always in the group, there would be those that would stir up a crowd. And they were agitators, stirring up a crowd and bringing great pressure and persecution upon Paul and Barnabas. And they did that also at this Antioch and Pisidia, and they persecuted and expelled them out of their land. So they came to Iconium. And as custom was, Paul would always go into the synagogues, the synagogue of the Jew, and he would preach the gospel there because his heart and his understanding was that to the Jew first, then the Gentile, that the Jews have been waiting for their Messiah. They've been taught the scriptures about Messiah to come. And now that Messiah has come in Jesus Christ, that he went and he shared that good news with his fellow Jewish brothers. Now there were those that would receive him, and then of course there were those that would reject that. Be a lot of the Greek individuals that would participate within the Jewish services. They would want to hear more about the God of Israel. And here I can understand a lot of the Greeks had many they were like, well, that makes sense that there has to be one who created all things, a designer. I mean, our very world speaks that this just didn't happen out of an explosion or chaos. Nothing ever can come into order that begins in disorder. You can't take something and explode something and see all the pieces fall into perfect, order. I mean, just send some of my grandkids into a room. Nothing of order comes out of that, okay? Absolutely nothing. So they realize that there has to be a God, a creator, a designer, and they wanted to know more about him. So you would find many of the Greeks or the Gentiles, the non-Jews, would participate and want to hear more about this God of Israel. So Paul would go into the synagogue, the church-like setting, if you would, and there he would speak about Jesus Christ. Now, just to let you know, you're going to be like getting cold and then hot and then cold again. It's the fall season and this thing doesn't know what to do. All right, it's going to warm you up and then it's going to cool you down, so hopefully you can get through the fall time. But, so Paul, let's begin in verse 1. And it says, "And it came to pass in Iconium that they went both together, Paul and Barnabas, into the synagogue of the Jews. And so spake that great multitude, both of the Jews and also of the Greeks, believed. So there were Jews and Greeks that heard that message and embraced it. Okay, there is a God. There's a designer, a creator. We understand that. The Jews knew him. Jehovah God, Yahweh, they knew their God. The Greeks would come in and say, this makes sense to me. There is a God. There's a creator, a designer. The human body just didn't happen. The creation itself didn't just happen. There had to be a designer. And then Paul went on and talked about, yes, there is. And as a designer creator, then you're accountable, and our accountability to him is the thing under scrutiny, because we're sinners. We've all blown it. We've done wrong. All of us have sinned. And so how do we reconcile our sin with a holy God? And he talked about the Messiah, Jesus Christ, who came, he lived, he died on our behalf. He took the penalty and punishment for us, and he owned it. He kind of like paid the debt, paid the fine for us. And as that message was preached, many believed. But the unbelieving Jews in verse 2 stirred up the Gentiles and made their minds evil, affected against the brethren. There will be always a group or an individual that will come in and they will stir up people against someone. They will come in and stir up and bring a false message or bring a not a full message of understanding. They will come in and they will come against those that are the messengers or those of the faith. It's a very dangerous thing to participate in gossip and slander. Very dangerous to participate in those things. In fact, I would encourage you, it's very dangerous to even listen to it. Don't even allow yourself to be a part of it. But there will always be someone that seems within the group that will come up and say, well, yeah, but I don't like what was done, and I don't like what was said, and this wasn't right, and if I was doing it, I wouldn't do it that way. Always someone to stir up your heart against a brother or sister in the faith. And you need to resist that. You need to not receive that, because it's a very dangerous thing. It's the sowing of discord among the brethren. It is one of the things that God hates, that he actually labels that he hates it. And if there's something that God hates, I don't want to find myself doing it. That's the wrong side to be on. But for some reason, they felt that, oh, yeah, we can do this, and because we don't agree with it. We don't agree with what's going on, so we're going to stir people up against them. You see it? I'll take it further. I believe it is a tool of the devil. It's a tool of Satan. And I believe we see that even in our culture today. If you have a different view, you will be vilified. You will be a problem just because you may hold a different view or conduct yourself in a different way than what those that would decree is the right way of doing things. And I think it's the spirit of Antichrist. And it is in the church here, if you would. And they stirred up the Gentiles and made their minds evil affected. They put an evil thought where now every time they would look at Paul and Barnabas, they would think, I wonder if that's true. I wonder. And it's dangerous, very dangerous. Look what Paul and Barnabas do? They're being persecuted. They're being vilified. They're having evil spoken against them. And look what they do. Long time, therefore, a bold day speaking boldly in the Lord. Oh, yeah, you don't like what we're saying? You're against us? You're coming against us? You're making us appear evil? Well, guess what? We're going to stay even longer. They didn't cut and run. It says that they stayed a long time continuing to share the truth, continuing to share the faith. Man, you're going to get attacked. You're going to get spoken evil of. You're going to get hammered from many areas, but don't cut and run. Don't bail out. Don't diminish in your effective witness for Christ or your continuance within a body or within the faith. Don't allow that to happen. That's a tool of the enemy that wants you to cut and run, to say, I'm done with it, I'm done with people, and then you just go on by yourself. Paul and Barnabas, they stayed. I know the tendency is, man, you know, it's I'm not being received, no one cares about me, no one's listening, you know, and whatever it is, and they want to leave. And God's saying, stay. Keep on. I've got a calling for you. I got a purpose. You don't see it right now because of all the stirring up, all the problems and situation. You don't see the fulfillment of it, but it's there for you. It's true. And I will bring it to pass. Just abide a little longer. And so they abode there a long time, it says, speaking boldly in the Lord, which gave testimony unto the word of his grace, and granted signs and wonders to be done by their hands. See, the signs and wonders were there to testify of the word that was spoken, the word of his grace. They were there to substantiate it, to bring that into light. Not that the signs and wonders were the end all, but it was there just to verify that the message is true and amen. And so the signs and wonders were done. And a lot of times I think, Lord, if only you would do a miracle in this person's life, man, they would turn to you. And so I'm praying hard, Lord, heal that brother, or heal, not brother, but I want him to be, heal that person so that they will be a brother in the faith. Heal that sister. Lord, do this. Let them know it's you. And you think that's going to do it. And then you think, man, if they only had that. And some people even live their life, well, if God does this, then I'll know he's God. And they play little games with God, you know. Like, you know, Lord, if you cause it to snow inside the house, then I'll believe. Well, first of all, I mean, you know, you're not thinking straight. Who in the world wants snow in their house? But anyways, if you do this, Lord, well, signs and wonders were done in their midst. And look at the next verse. But the multitude of the city was divided. Part held with the Jews and part with the apostles. The signs and the wonders didn't change half the people. And I found that if they don't have ears to hear, they won't have eyes to see. That faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so it's not necessarily true that if a miracle took place, they would then believe. Their ears are still closed to the gospel. Pray that they have ears to hear, that they would hear the message of God's grace. And notice it also says apostles. It's very important because some don't see the gifts of God continuing past the 12 apostles. But here Barnabas, through the Holy Spirit, in the writing of the text was considered an apostle. He was considered one that was sent out by God. And God indeed did send them out from Antioch as they were praying. And he was sent out. Now, he might not have been an apostle as one that would pen scripture, but nevertheless, he was sent out by God, and the Spirit labels it such in the plural form as they sided with the Jews or with the apostles, Paul and Barnabas. And when there was assault made both of the Gentiles and also of the Jews with their rulers to use them despitefully and to stone them, that all of a sudden pressure was mounting. I mean, it was getting pretty thick. That here they were going to now stone them. And they were aware of it and fled onto Lystra and Derbe. Now might be the time they leave. If you dig down into the text, it basically means that their very life was being threatened, that they fled, meaning they were running for their lives. That there was a hot pursuit to kill these guys, and they were running for their lives out of there. And so here as they moved forward and God actually moved them on into Lystra and Derbe. And they fled onto Lystra and Derbe, cities of Lycaonia, and onto the region that lieth round about. And there they preached the gospel. They went right back doing it. This is what they were called to do. Okay, they got pressure. They got hammered. They got threatened. They were ready to be killed. And they continued to do what their calling was, to preach the gospel. They didn't look back and say, well, you know, I don't see much success. I don't see the profit of this. What I believe is they stood on what they were called to do and let God sort out the results. That God, you've called us to do this and we're going to do it. We need to stay faithful to what God's called us to do and not look at just the results of what's going on or the pressure that we're feeling or be bound by the circumstances around us. But what did God call me to do? And I will do it until he tells me to leave. And here, obviously, at this point, he said, now go. And there are examples of this that we see, if you remember, that God said that there is a season that if it's not received, if it's not done, if something happens, God will show you, and there and then you can shake the dust off your feet and move on. And here, as this situation unfolded, they didn't stop the work they were doing, just the location. They didn't stop the work. They continued on. And even in that location, they stayed a very long time until they were running for their life, but they stayed. How important it is to let God direct our path. And so they went to Lystra and Derbe, and they preached the gospel. And there sat a certain man of Lystra, an impotent in his feet, being a cripple from his mother's womb, who never had walked. I like that. If you read that again in verse 8, it says there was a certain man. And here, Luke, the one who was the physical one who penned the gospel, directed by the Spirit of God, but here Dr. Luke described him and gave these accounts to let us know the state of this man. He was impotent in his feet. He was no strength in his feet whatsoever. He was crippled from birth. This happened during the birthing process or upon the completion of it, he was crippled. And then it says, never walked, never had the weight of his body bearing down on his legs. He could never walk. And so Luke really describes the state of this man. This wasn't someone that had a broken leg. This wasn't someone that, you know, had a car accident or a chariot accident or whatever. This was someone that was completely without strength or ability to walk from his birth. This was someone that it was very, very serious, his condition. And so he's there, and the same heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding him and perceiving that he had faith to be healed. And so this man is intensely listening to the message of God's grace, the message of the hope of Jesus Christ. And how he must have embraced that, a crippled man like myself, a man, not a young boy, but a man who's gone through life with so many disadvantages, such rejection from the people around me, some people just mocking me and laughing at me when they pass by, and then here's a message of God's grace. Jesus, God himself loves you with an everlasting love. In fact, he has a hope and a future for you. And I can imagine the guy thinking, for me? A hope for me? I have no hope. I can't stand. I can't walk. I've never been able to. I've been an inconvenience. I've been a laughing stock for other people. I've been the butt of jokes all around the city. Me? God has a hope and a future for me? I can't believe it. And he intensely was listening, and Paul saw that. As Paul was speaking, he could tell that this man is listening. This man wants God in his life. And so after he was speaking, it moves on and it says, and the same heard Paul speak, and Paul said with a loud voice in verse 10, stand up on thy feet. And he leaped and walked. That's amazing. Feet and legs that never knew how to bear weight. Muscles that were so, you know, into atrophy that they never knew how to flex. Nerve endings that were probably gone. Circulation that was inhibited. All the things that would be necessary to make this man walk again if you did it through surgery. And then how long of physical therapy would need to be done to cause this to happen? And yet, at the mention of the name of Jesus, he leaped up, rise up and walk. And he didn't just stand, man, he leaped. He's like, I'm going to do something that I only dreamed of doing. He might have saw other kids leaping. I don't know what they did back then. We used to play leapfrog, you know, and that was cool when I was 35 and... But now I hurt Kathy when I don't make it all the way. It's bad. But he probably thought, okay, I can do this. And he jumped right up and he leaped. And then he began to walk. And I thought, how God will put everything in order in a person's life, so that they could walk and testify of his glory. That nothing's too hard for God. He'll put everything in order. And maybe he's been working on some muscles in your life for something that's up ahead. Maybe a few nerve endings. And you're feeling them. They're a little raw right now. And you're like, man, that hurts. And he's using other people to test those nerve endings. You're like, I'm not happy with this. But it's needed. Exactly. That's okay. Is that a message from above? You've been watching too much of the Ten Commandments. Moses, yeah. God can put everything in alignment so that we can actually jump up and praise our God and walk in the faith. And I just want to encourage you, maybe God's doing that in your life. Maybe with the situations you're facing, certain things need to be worked through or tested or sometimes manipulated. If you ever gone to physical therapy, sometimes you don't know if they're helping you. You think, you're trying to kill me. And they're like, no, stay with it. You know, long term. If you hurt me once again, there's not going to be any long term here. And yet God, in his perfect ways, knows exactly how to put things in order, even if it's painful, to make things right in your life for his glory. And you need to let him do that. And this man intensely looked to God through the message for his healing, for his hope, for his future. He realized, I can't do it myself. I can't. Only God can do what's needed to be done in my life. And thereupon the message, he turned to God. And Paul saw that and he said, rise up. Rise up. And the man leaped up, jumped to his feet, and he walked. And when the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of the Lyconia, the gods are come down to us in the likeness of men. And I thought, what would I do if I heard that? I might want to take, now let's get this straight. You're talking God with a small g, right? Okay, we can deal with that. But when Paul and Barnabas heard of it, they weren't going to receive it because they knew God deserved all the glory. That it wasn't them, that it was God. And so the people, not knowing, they're used to pagan worship. In fact, the worship of Jupiter and Mercury or Mercurius, They were done in that area. They were temples in that area. In so much that, look what it says. It says, and they called Barnabas Jupiter, Jupiter being the taller one, and Paul Mercurius, because he was the chief speaker. So he would be the one that was the spokesman, the one that would speak eloquently about the gospel. And so they assume that these are the gods because history in the past has taught that at times the gods had visited them. And so they thought, well, great, the gods are here again and we better do things right. And the priest of Jupiter, which was before their city, brought oxen. Can you imagine? You know, all of a sudden someone runs to the temple and says, hey, priest, what? I want you to know that your God is here, and he's in the main court of the city. Wait, what? What? My God, the one that we're sacrificing? Yeah. You better do something about it. So he grabs up some sacrifices, and he runs down thinking, okay, my God has come down. And so he came, and he brought oxen and garlands unto the gates and would have done sacrifice with the people, which when the apostles, Barnabas and Paul heard of it, they rent their clothes and ran in among the people, crying out and saying, "Sirs, why do you these things? We also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein." What I like is when they came and they spoke to them, they began their message about God in a very simplistic way. They didn't move into theology, because these people weren't trained in theology. They didn't know the Old Testament. They didn't have a knowledge of the doings of the God of Israel, for the most part. And so Paul approached them very simplistically and did not try to quote Old Testament scripture, which he had done to fellow Jews in the past, but he gave the basic understanding, the God of all creation, the God that has created all things. This is the one, and this is the thing that we preach, and the one whom we preach, who in times past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways, that though the nations were evil, God gave them a free will to walk in those ways. He gave them the right to walk in their own ways, which actually was against God, was actually going contrary to the works of God. But then it says, nevertheless, he left not himself without witness, and that he did good and gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. What a message to tell these people, hey, there really is a God that created all things. Creation itself declares there had to be a designer. And though you didn't know him, though you never acknowledged him, you never said, okay, God, I can believe in energy always existing, and somehow that energy created everything, or I can believe in a designer that always existed, I choose the designer. It makes more sense. The way everything is put together, it makes more sense that a designer always existed instead of some random energy source. And so now, I never acknowledged you, Paul saying, you never acknowledged him. You went about and did your own things, walked contrary, didn't listen to what he had to say, but nevertheless, he showed his love and his grace, because you still ate, didn't you? You still got rain from heaven. Water to drink. He still, even though you didn't know him, he knows you. And he's there for you, and he wants you to know him. And he gave a witness from time to time to let you know there's got to be more to this world than just what I see. There has to be a designer over it all. And he gave that witness in the food and the water and the things that he's blessed your heart with. And with gladness. And with these sayings, scarce restrained they the people, that they did not do this sacrifice unto them. That they were so motivated by their past understandings that they were compelled within them to make sacrifice in this pagan culture. But by the words that were shared, they held back. It was hard for them. They were so used to doing what they've always done, but they held back and they did not sacrifice unto Paul and Barnabas. And there came, you gotta love these guys. And there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium, who persuaded the people. There are always those that are going to push you over the edge in the negative. You finally got a grip on things, and you're finally not going to do something foolish, and there's always that last little push, that last little temptation to just push you over the edge. That's where I need personally, if I just extrapolate that from the text in this way, I need the restraint of the Holy Spirit. Because there will always be a temptation that is one more that wants to push me into doing wrong. And I need the restraint of the Spirit of God. I need the Lord to be my defense, my helper. I need to constantly look to Him. Keep me, Lord, on the right path. I'm this close sometimes from going off the edge. This close. Lord, I need You. I need You the day that You saved me, and I need You every day until I take me home. And then I need You for all eternity. I need You, Lord. But there were certain of the Jews from these places, from Antioch and Iconium, that persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul and drew him out of the city, supposed he had been dead. They stoned him. They were about to make sacrifice to them. They called them their gods, Jupiter and Mercury. And that quickly, those that may accept and bless you may be the ones that persecute and attack you. How quickly people can change. Applauding you, wow, we're so blessed. I can't take it anymore. Get out of here. Leave me. Don't stay. You're like, what in the world just happened to us? We were praised 1 minute and stoned the next, killed. The fickleness of man to give either accolades and then right around give insults. And here, Paul, now they were done with his message. We don't want to hear from you anymore. We're tired of what you're saying. We don't like what you've been doing. We don't like the way you've been talking, the things you've been standing for, and we're done with you. And so they were finished with him, and they stoned him to death. And then they dragged his body, and they threw him on the garbage heap just so that wild animals could devour him. They were done. But God wasn't done with him. God was not done with Paul. Though these people didn't want to hear the message, God would raise him up and send him somewhere where people would hear. God's not done with you. Man may be, not God. So here, Paul, in this experience, we found that you wonder what was happening. And Paul even explains it in Corinthians. He talks about it there. He says, 14 years ago, there was a man, he says, in the body or out of the body, I can't tell you. But he was raised up to the third heaven, which was considered paradise. And there he heard the unspeakable things of God, things that were unlawful for him to even bring back down and share. Makes me wonder sometimes on these after-death experiences when they have this whole litmus of things that happened. Some may be good and true, I don't know, but Paul wasn't allowed to share any of it, of what he saw in paradise. He wasn't allowed to share it. And so he said, whether I was dead or alive, I don't know. And just that phrase hit me because there are some times after I get beat down and beat down and beat down and hammered that sometimes I don't know if I'm dead or alive. I have no clue. Sometimes I'm going through the motions. Because, you know, he started, think of this, he was called by God. The Holy Spirit came to Antioch and said, send, take Paul and Barnabas and send them out for the work. And I could imagine with the fanfare, all the brothers around them, Lord, bless our brother Paul and our brother Barnabas. Fill them with your Spirit. Use them mightily for your kingdom and send them forth for your glory. And then they were sent out. And man, the joy, you know, I'm gonna share the gospel. I'm gonna bring the message of hope. I'm gonna tell people about the love of the Lord. And you're almost kind of light on your feet and you're going into situation, man, Jesus loves you. Let me tell you about the Lord. Let me tell you about Jesus Christ. And God's using you and you're excited. And then all of a sudden, you get hit down a little bit. And you're like, oh, what was that? All I'm trying to do is talk about Jesus and I'm getting attacked. What was that? And you kind of shake it off and you're like, okay, let me tell you about the Lord. Boom, you get hit again. Blindsided, where'd that come from? That was from a brother, supposed sister. And you're trying to get back up a little bit and you're like, okay, I'm gonna still go forward and talk about the Lord. Now Jesus is the Son of God, and boom, you get hit with another trial, a situation, and all of a sudden you're trying and you're heavy and you clap. And he lifts me up. And then he speaks his word once again into my heart. And I'm ready to go forward in the faith once again. And here Paul was cast down as dead. And notice this. I think there's something important about this. Howbeit, as the disciples stood round about him. How I need believers to stand round about me. How I need to stay in the fellowship of the saints. I need you round about me. I don't know what they're doing, lamenting, praying, seeking God, but whatever it was, by the hand of God, Paul stood up. And we need to stand round about one another, because there are times that probably all of us don't know if we're dead or alive. Don't even know. We've been knocked down so many times, I don't want to get up. I just want to go home. And God says, get up. Your work's not finished. I will be with you. And you got brothers. When you open your eyes, you'll see there's brothers standing next to you. They're standing there. And Paul gets up and he looks. And there's his brothers standing around about him. And he says, let's go on. And notice what he does. He gets up and he rose up and he came into the city. Now, if I was a brother of Paul, I'm like, oh, no, wait a minute, Paul. You're going back to the place they stoned you? Yeah. Yeah, the work's not done. Let's keep going. They went back into the city, and the next day he departed, and with Barnabas to Derbe, we got to continue. And I want to encourage you, you might have been hammered over and over again. You might have even fallen down and inside spiritually said, I'm not rising up again. Oh, I'll go through the motions. I may even attend church, but I'm not getting involved anymore. Not me. I've been hurt too many times. And then God speaks to you, some unspeakable word to your heart, and reminds you He's with you. He hasn't left you. And His calling is still upon your life. So get up and go forward in the faith. And so Paul goes forward. And when they had preached the gospel to that city and taught many, they returned again to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch. They started making their way back through the places they were. They wanted their witness not only to go forward, but to continue to be presented to those that were before them. They kept the witness alive and continued in the faith, even back onto Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith. Now they had a reference point. I'm telling you, continue in the faith. But Paul, you don't know how hard it's been. Yes, I do. But you don't know the attacks. I know of them. And I'm here to tell you, I've been beaten down, I've been hammered, I've been lied about, I've been accused. But God hasn't stopped and taken away His calling on my life, and that is what I must walk in. So I encourage you, continue in the faith. Continue in the faith that we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. Continue. Keep going. In this world, you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer. He has overcome the world. He will lead you in the path through it. Don't collapse on the path. Let the hand of God reach and pick you up. Now, in closing, Paul speaks of this to young Timothy about what he's encouraging Timothy to do by his own past. In fact, let's look at it. Let's turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Turn to 2 Timothy, and we'll close with this. 2 Timothy. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, let's look at verse 10. Here, Paul the Apostle is sharing with Timothy, "But thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, purpose of faith, long-suffering, charity, and patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, Iconium." Persecution, but God has delivered me. Hold on to that, my brothers and sisters. God will deliver you. Hold on to that. And let Him make it so. Let Him make it real. And don't let your falls stop you from walking in your callings. Don't let it. Because man may have been done with Paul, but God wasn't. God had many more people's ears to hear the gospel through Paul's lips, and God's not done with you. Let Him raise you up and send you back into the calling He's called you. Father, thank You for this time in Your Word. We thank You for allowing us to be able to hear Your voice in those times that we're struggling. And when those times that we're down, Lord, may you hear your voice that tells us to rise up, to get up, to keep going. That, Lord, that you haven't finished your work with us, but, Lord, that you want to fill us and you want to refresh us so that we can walk forward in the faith, continuing what you've asked us to do. Lord, may we hear your voice that would call out our name and tell us to get up and get back in the fight. For you are with us, and you will never leave us nor forsake us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.